Mindsetters, welcome to Learn Extra Live. I'm Katleho and this is Aslam. How are you today?
Great, Katleho.
Good. Today, remember that we're doing, what are we doing? Tell us what we're doing today.
The main subject, life sciences.
Life sciences.
There you go.
What will we be doing today? Just some revision?
Paper one revision, and we're going to then move on to some paper two revision
okay.
as well.
Okay, awesome. So you guys heard that we're doing both paper one and paper two revision. I hope you guys are ready and jacked up and ready to go because today's going to be an awesome show. Let me tell them about it while you go over to your board. Remember that you can get hold of us in various ways today. Today we have our Facebook, facebook.com/learnextra, and our Twitter handle is @learnextra. And today we're even on our, you can even phone us. You can even phone us just to let us know how you're doing and let us know the questions that you have on revision. Remember that take it from the beginning of the year and bring it up to this point so that your prelims are on the ball. Not only prelims, but you're also writing. So make sure that you call us. Our number is 086-105-8262. And the first five callers today will be getting these winter school booklets for free, sent to you directly so that you can have everything that you need. And from me, I'm going to take a little bit of a break while you get all your pens, papers, everything sorted for this fantastic show. See you after the break, guys. Welcome back, Mindsetters. I hope you guys are having a nice, snuggly, cuddly June 16. And you guys know exactly what it's about. You're at the right place for your good June 16 today. So I hope you're going to enjoy us as much as we enjoy you. Aslam, we're ready for you. Take it away.
Thank you, Katleho. Welcome, Mindsetters. We were busy the last time with paper one meiosis, and we take it from there. Just before we actually go to the question, just a simple explanation on the last thing that we did, and that was polyploidy. Poly meaning many, ploidy meaning the number of chromosomes. Polyploidy is a condition, people, when cells in a particular organism, all the cells, have more than two sets of chromosomes. So we have a situation where during meiosis, if the chromosomes do not separate, mainly during anaphase, if this happens, then obviously one of the gametes would have an extra set of chromosomes, meaning it would be diploid instead of haploid. That means 2N instead of N. Now we know from our study of meiosis that when gametes are produced, the number of chromosomes is usually reduced to half. So that when these gametes come together during fertilization, then the individual that is formed from there would have the full complement of chromosomes. However, in this particular case, when these chromosomes do not separate, a particular gamete would have double. Now, if this particular sperm or egg fuses with another gamete, then 2 plus 1 would give you 3N, triploid. And if this in turn continues, or if two of those gametes fuse with each other, you'll get tetraploid. And so on, we can go on. In that way, we're saying that this particular organism has more than two sets of the chromosome number, and therefore it's polyploid. It's mainly used in the agricultural industry with plants. We find many plants that are polyploid. Reason being, they have larger flowers, larger fruit. So in other words, that's better for industry. Also, they become drought resistant. Again, good for industry so that they do not lose crops in that way. And we get many seedless varieties. Grapes that are seedless, watermelon that are seedless. These are all examples of polyploid organisms. We now move on to the questions for today. And the first one on the board is a diagram here. It says, study the following diagram and answer the questions that follow. This particular diagram tells you clearly at the bottom, it is a karyotype of a person. Notice the karyotype diagram. It shows you the setup of, or you can say it's a map of the chromosomes in the autosomes. In this case here, or rather the somatic cells, I should say. In this case, you can see there's pair 1 right up to pair 23. In humans, obviously, we have 23 pairs of chromosomes. We have 46 altogether, so therefore we had 23 pairs. So you need to look at this diagram clearly and see what is happening, and then we move to the questions. And as we go through the questions, we would be able to understand how this diagram actually works. The first question given there, is this the karyotype of a male or a female? Male or female? Now, to understand or to determine the sex of an individual from a karyotype, we only have to look at one set of chromosomes, and this is pair number 23. In this particular instance, you can clearly see that pair number 23 are identical, they look the same. You're not getting one taller and one shorter. And yes, people, don't confuse these things here for X's. Many of you think that these are X's. These are not X's, they represent chromosomes. So in this particular case, we look at 23, the two X chromosomes are identical, and therefore this is a female. If for some reason these chromosomes were drawn, something to that effect, and one small one there, then you know, because what many learners misunderstand is when they see this here that looks like an X, they think that that's two X chromosomes. You must not look at the letter X in this particular case, because that's not the answer. These are not X's, these are chromosomes. So you've got to look at the size of the chromosome. If they are of the same size, that means they are two X chromosomes. If they are of different size, like these two here, then one is an X and one is a Y. And in that case, it would be a male. Okay, I've given you the reason already. Give a reason for your answer, because this particular individual has two X chromosomes. How many chromosomes does this person have? Now, this, you don't have to be a rocket scientist. You just need to know simple arithmetic and how to count. If you look right across here for a start, you can do it individually, 1, 2, 3, 4, that would take very long. But if you look across here, there are 23 sets. And most of them have two per set. And 23 times 2 is 46. But, wait a minute, set number 21 has one extra there. It doesn't have two, it has three. So that's plus one. So this particular individual has 47 chromosomes. Name the genetic disorder that this person has. Again, back to the diagram. Remember, all our questions are related to this diagram, and therefore we need to look at this diagram every time we are working. Now, look at this particular case. This person has an extra chromosome here by chromosome number 21, and this is prescribed in your curriculum, and you know that if a person has an extra chromosome, particularly on chromosome set number 21, this person suffers from Down's syndrome. So our answer there is Down's syndrome. And let's just go back to the diagram, just clearly just to understand what we have to know in this diagram again in the future. Number one, there are 23 sets. The 23rd set deals with the sex of the individual. Look out especially at number 21 to see if there are only two chromosomes or there are three. If there are two, the person is considered normal. If there are three there on chromosome set number 21, then obviously this person is suffering from Down syndrome. You are also required to know the symptoms of Down syndrome as well. Okay, we move on to question number 7. And now, people, we move from meiosis to genetics. So you need to understand this section well before you can answer these questions. Just a handy piece of advice. Remember always that you need to know the terminology to be able to solve these problems. And like any problem, the more you practice the problem, the easier it will become to solve the problem. The more questions you look at in this particular section, the better it's going to be long term. Now this one here is a very clear diagram that gives us, study the diagrams below and show some that show breeding experiments on mice. single pair of alleles showing complete dominance. Clue. First clue there, complete dominance controls coat color, white or gray in these mice. Now they're giving you the diagram and they're showing you this set of mice, they mated and all the offspring are gray. All right, this two here, they also mated and they have all gray offspring. And the last two there have some white offspring and some gray offspring as well. So there's a diagram. Instead of giving you a problem in words, they simply put it in a diagram so you can see what's happening. But now, they didn't mention anything about homozygous, heterozygous, genotype, phenotype. Now, these are the words in your toolbox that you've got to carry with you when you're answering these questions. The first one says, state which sex chromosomes would be present in the gametes of parent mouse 2 and mouse 3. Let's go back up. Mouse 3 and mouse 4. Am I right? Mouse 2 and 3, sorry. So we are looking at that one and that one. This is a male and that's a female. And from the question that we just dealt with just now, obviously this one here is a male, so he would have X, Y. Remember, the Y determines maleness. If the Y chromosome is absent, then the organism would be a female. Has to be X, Y. If it's XX, then it's a female. So that would obviously give us the answer to this one, XX. That is the sex chromosome. Remember, when they're talking about sex chromosome, it's either XX or XY. Nothing else. Okay? The next one says, if mice 3 and 4 had a second set of offspring, what is the percentage chance that the first mouse would be a female? Now, that's an interesting question, and it comes up often in the papers. And we need to look at this very carefully. I'm not going to do the whole setup, because we're going to look at the setup just now again. So I'm just going to look at maleness and femaleness. Remember, the chromosomes that control that are the XX and the XY. So this would be the mother, and that would be the father. If we then put that in a Punnett square, I'm skipping all the steps of gametes and the rest of it. We're going straight to the XX, keep what's on the left, whatever's on the right on the top, easier to work with. XX, XX again, XY, XY. So what does this particular Punnett square tell us? It tells us that every time fertilization takes place, there's a 50% chance being male and an equal chance being female. So whenever they ask you this question, the answer will remain the same. Whether these mice had 1,548 offspring and they're asking you about the next one, whether they had 2 million offspring, wow, then too, the answer would be the same. The answer will always be 50%. Which of the parents, 1, 2, 3, or 4, is likely to be homozygous dominant for coat color? Which of the parents, mice 1, 2, 3, or 4, is likely to be homozygous? Now, guys, let's understand. Homozygous means, first of all, that the gene and its allele are identical. So in other words, if the gene is coding for gray coat color, then the allele, that's its partner, must also code for gray color. And the other side of this one, another term, is heterozygous. Heterozygous. Here, the gene and its allele are different. In this example, if the gene is coding for gray coat, then its allele is coding for white coat. That's what we need to understand here. Now they want to know which one is homozygous for the dominant color. First of all, nobody told us in this diagram which is the dominant color. We needed to work that out. And to work it out, we need to look at the diagram. Look at this particular cross in the first place. In this particular cross, gray mouse, white mouse, all the offspring are gray. Then we took two gray mice and we get a similar setup there as well. Now that tells us an important thing, that gray is probably dominant. And obviously it can't be mouse number one. So we take out that one from the equation. We obviously strike out mouse number four. So it leaves us with two and three. Now look at the offspring of two, wherever two had a cross. In this instance, all gray. In this instance, all gray. But with three, in this instance, it gave us all gray. But in this instance, some white offspring came out. So obviously, gray cannot be homozygous for, mouse three cannot be homozygous for gray. So it can only be mouse number two. The answer would be mouse number two. Please understand, not the answer, but the reasoning behind how we got to this answer. That's the important part. Obviously, in this year, you play the game of elimination. You want to know for gray coat color. So obviously, the white ones are out. They're out of this equation. And it leaves us with these two. We look at this one here. In all instances, it's giving us gray. And that one, on the other hand, gave us gray and white. So most probably, mouse number two is homozygous for the dominant color. Then they say, state why mouse 3 can only be heterozygous for coat color. Now, if you worked out this answer here, then this answer becomes obvious. Why? Let's go back. When we looked at these mice and their offspring, we found that mouse 3 had gray and white offspring. Because it has gray and white, it would necessitate that mouse to have a characteristic for white. Remember, the offspring get their two alleles, one from the mother and one from the father. That one is obvious. The white is already there. But if this one contributed the gray factor, the gray allele, the dominant allele, then this is the result. In other words, if you use letters, this would be GG. If we use gray for dominant and small, capital G for dominant and small g for recessive. And these ones would be GG, as you can see there. So obviously, why are we saying that this had to be heterozygous? Because this particular parent had both gray offspring and white offspring. So this particular female would have had to have the recessive characteristic which she passed on to the offspring.
Time for a quick break. Guys, I know that some of you have even said that you're really enjoying this lesson, and I know that you are. Take everything down, take everything in, and make sure that you're refreshed and ready after this quick break. Welcome back, Mindsetters. Remember that we are doing Life Sciences Grade 12 revision on both Paper 1 and Paper 2. I know that this is an awesome lesson because you guys are writing on this. And even if you have written, prelims are very close and so are other tests that you may have. So I know that this is going to be awesome for that and you're all going to ace it. I also want to remind you on the winter school that will be taking place from the 2nd of July to the 8th. And it is a boot camp. It is awesome. It is hectic. And you guys must be so ready for that. And remember that it's winter. So you must also keep warm and keep safe and stay indoors and study rather than going outside and getting yourself sick. And when you're indoors, make sure that you tune into Channel 319 because it is an awesome, awesome winter show for us. Over to you, Aslam.
Thank you, Godlego. Okay, guys, welcome back again. And we're going through our genetics question. Just before that, we had a question earlier about viruses that was sent through to us, and the learner wanted to know how do viruses live inside organisms when they do not have a nucleus? Very easy. Remember when you did viruses, by the way, the actual structure and functioning of viruses is from grade 11 and not for grade 12, but it's linked to DNA, so we will just answer the question very quickly for you. Remember that viruses do not have a nucleus, but they do have DNA or RNA, not both. And it is this DNA and RNA that enables them to reproduce more viruses when they get into your body or a body of any organism. The DNA or RNA is injected to a cell or cells inside the body, and the DNA and RNA replicate, they make more copies, and the cell which they infected then bursts, releasing more viruses there. They are considered to be non-living because they cannot respire, they cannot metabolize, they do not have mitochondria, etc. But once inside the living cell, they are able to reproduce only using the DNA. I hope that answered that question. Let's move on. This question here is a useful investigative planning type of question which examiners have been seeming to favor in the last few exams. This particular one says, a fingerprint is a useful way of identifying people and classifying them into groups. We know in South Africa, the minute you apply for an ID, as in any other country, your fingerprints are taken. So on the database, your fingerprint is already there. Your ID is registered to your fingerprint. So we can be classified according to that. Fingerprint is taken by rolling the right index finger on an ink pad and then onto a piece of paper. You probably, grade 12s, by now you should have your ID. Remember, you need your ID for the end of the year to identify yourself in an exam center. So you should have your ID. So you should have had this experience of taking your fingerprint or having your fingerprints taken. During a discussion of this topic, a group of learners asked the following question. Which one of the five main types of fingerprints is most common amongst the learners of this school? The three main groups of fingerprints, by the way, are either arced, whorled, and the last one I forget at this moment. I'll get back to you on that one. For some reason it's not coming to me, blanked. I'll get back to you on that one just now. But these are the types of fingerprints that we have. And what they're saying is they want to know which one is most common. And they want to ask the first question, state any four steps in the planning process. State any four steps in the planning process. Now, guys, planning is not restricted to science. It's not restricting to math. It's not restricted to this particular experiment. Planning is planning. Wherever you do planning, whatever the function, whatever the job you have to do, the planning steps will be the same. If you are planning the matric farewell, that should be relevant to you right now, then you would firstly want to know how many learners you have in the matric farewell. You would also want to know where the venue you would choose. You'd also want to know what is the menu, etc., etc. So these are planning steps. Now, in this particular thing, we want to know what? We want to know what is the most common type of fingerprint. Oh, by the way, that thing came back to me. Looped. There we go. Arced, whorled, or looped. Those are the three main categories. And within these categories, there are other categories. By the way, mindsetters, don't get worried because you do not have to know the fingerprints themselves. It is not part of your curriculum. If a question like this is given, then obviously if they need to know the names would be in the passage. So don't fret, don't drink too much of coffee, don't get an energy. Wow, I need some energy because I don't know these things here. No, it's not going to help you. It's not going to be a problem if you don't. These things are going to be given in the question, okay? It happened to me on live show. I forgot, I got it back. And in the paper, same thing, guys. If you forget something while you are answering question 1.3.2, don't sit and say 1.3.2, 1.3.2. I can't get this in my head. I have to stay here. You're losing time in that time. Same in accounting. If you are balancing your books and your books don't balance, many learners waste minutes and minutes and minutes trying to balance the book. In the meanwhile, the balance itself is only 3 to 4 marks, and they leave the rest of the question blank. If you have this blank moment, move on with your paper, and at the end, you come back to this question, making sure that you left a space on your answer book for this particular question. So you know, as a reminder, that I haven't answered this question. Also, so that you keep parts of a question together. Because when markers mark, generally, the way marking is done is markers mark a particular question. So there's some team marking question 2, 3, 4, 5, etc., and they will mark that one. If you're going to put your answers all over the show, the guy marking question 2 may miss something, and then it'll be come back later from someone else and so on. So rather keep parts of a question together. So in this one here, obviously we're dealing with learners at a school. So first of all, we must determine the sample size, putting it in scientific terms now. In other words, what we're saying here, guys, is how many people are we going to investigate? Are we going to investigate the whole school? Are we going to investigate only the grade 12 learners? Etc., etc., etc. So we must determine the sample size. Obviously, because of the nature of this particular exercise, and what you have to do, you have to use a rubber pad, ink pad, and you've got to get that. So make sure you acquire the equipment. I'm writing in general terms, people, because in an exam, you will not get exactly this question here, maybe. It's some other planning. So any planning will require equipment. And in this case, you will specify. You will get paper and the ink pad, etc. Now, when you collect the results of any investigation, how are you going to present it? So then you're going to have to decide on how the data will be presented or collected and presented, etc. And obviously, just like the matric farewell, you'd obviously need to have the venue. Where are you going to do this? You can also add to this. There's 1,000 other things you can add. You can add, for example, determine who is going to be the person that's going to take the fingerprints. Who is going to record it, etc., etc., logistical issues. So in other words, any planning, people, whether it's here or anywhere else, it's going to be the same. Okay? Provide a hypothesis. Now look at this question carefully. Provide a hypothesis for the question the learners asked. They don't want just any hypothesis. They want a hypothesis based on the question the learners have asked. Now, just before we go to the question that the learners ask, remember, a hypothesis is a predictive or predicted statement. It is not a question. It is not a conclusion. It is not an aim. For example, aim, we want to know, to determine which particular fingerprint type is the most prevalent in this class or in the school. That's an aim. That's why we're doing this experiment. So it's not a hypothesis. Okay? And it's not a question. Is, so the question we go back to, let's go to the question and show you what is a question again. Which one of the five main types of fingerprints is most common among the learners at this school? That's a question. So you can't repeat that question here, because this is the question that these learners wanted to answer. Now, a hypothesis is usually done before the experiment is done. In other words, somebody is saying, you know what, I think X, Y, and Z. Not just thinking wildly, but based on what they think, what they know, their knowledge, etc., they're making a hypothesis. Okay? And if we go to that again, to this question, let's go to the question. So they want to know which type of the main types of fingerprints is common. In a hypothesis, we must look at the independent variable and the dependent variable and the relationship. That's why you get 3 marks for this. Because you must show the independent variable, you must show the dependent variable and the relationship for it. That's why it has to be put in a form of a statement. You must take a stand. You cannot say which one is going to be more. No, you've got to say one of them. For example, we said earlier, we're looking at arced, whirled, looped. So any one of those words you could have used there, that is your independent variable. The arc, the whirled, the loop type. Those are the different types. Is more prevalent among the learners. Is most common among the learners of the school. So we're already saying is most common. Most denotes a comparison. You are taking a stand that this particular one, or this one, or this one, or whatever, you can say X, Y, Z, whatever in this particular answer, is the most prevalent in the school. And remember, hypotheses are causal statements. That means these are because of that as well sometimes. For example, I may say, if I give her a diamond ring, she will marry me. Wow. If I give her a diamond ring, she will marry me. Now look at that. It's what I am predicting. It's not the truth. How do I figure that out now? I've got to go with that diamond ring and present it to her. She may take the diamond ring, turn around and run out of the restaurant and leave me high and dry. Or she may somehow clap me right there in the restaurant in front of everybody. That wouldn't be a good thing.
Yeah, no, would that, that would be a horrible thing.
Terrible, terrible, terrible. Or she might as well, she might just say, yes, darling, I take you to be your lawful wedded wife forever and ever. That would be good, no?
Yeah, that would
after
be the
ideal. After my investment of the diamond ring. So can you see, in a hypothesis, there are many ways in which after that something can happen. So the experiment is my actually taking the diamond ring and giving it to her. And after that, I must decide whether my hypothesis was correct or not. So remember, hypothesis, guys, is not something that is only restricted to science. Every single day, you and I, every single one of us is making a hypothesis of sort. If I take this road, I'll get there quickly. If I brush my teeth, I will not get tooth decay, etc., etc., etc. If I study hard, I will get a good result. These are all hypotheses that we are doing every day. So get in your mind one such hypothesis, and whenever you get a hypothesis question, try and fit that hypothesis question into your particular question, or hypothesis, sorry. This one here shows you a pedigree diagram of inheritance of flower color in a certain plant over three generations. Use the symbols for contrasting alleles. W, capital W, notice another clue here, capital W is given for white color and R for red color. Now, when I put this question up, something moved in the diagram, so I'm going to correct that first. This should be a red flower, and that should be mixed red white flower. In other words, they're saying that both red and white show in this particular pedigree. Now, guys, in a pedigree is very easy. All you need to know is your work in terms of genotypes, etc., and your phenotypes. And in this case, you need to know the difference between complete dominance, incomplete dominance, and codominance. Complete dominance is when one particular characteristic covers or masks the other one. And we looked at an example just now with the gray coat and the white coat of those mice. The gray coat was the dominant feature, and therefore it masks out the white one. The white one could only show itself if the gray one was absent. I like to use the word, when the cats are away, the mice will play. So in other words, the dominant one is the cat, the recessive one is the mice. When the dominant one is there, you cannot see the mice, you cannot see the recessive one. When the cat is not there, the dominant one, then the mice will appear. Therefore, you'll see when you get a recessive characteristic like the other one we looked at, GG, only when that showed up, we got the white. Before that, we did not get the white. Now let's look at this diagram. First of all, they're telling you that we're mating red and white, and you notice you're getting a something in between there. You're not getting red, you're not getting white, but you're getting something new, a red and white flower. So that tells you that these two characteristics, red and white, are equally dominant. So this is an example of co-dominance. Please understand that. In a case of incomplete dominance, you won't get a mixture of red and white. You will get a new color. For example, if we had red and white here and we get pink, that means that these two colors are neither of them are dominant over the other, and they have now formed a new blend. So please watch that when you are doing that. Type of inheritance, codominance. Explain your answer, because both characteristics showed themselves equally when this was crossed. Last one there, use the symbol R and W to write down the genotypes of each. In the case of A, let's look at A quickly. A is red, B is the mixed color and C is the white. Okay, let's go back. Red will be R. B was the mixed one, so it'd be capital R, capital W, and C would be capital W, capital W. Remember, in this case, both characteristics are used in capital because both are dominant. Over to you, Katleho.
Thank you. Guys, we'll be shooting over to a very quick break. This is for you to get all your questions that you may have, or maybe queries, or maybe you just didn't understand a little part that happened. Let us know during this break so that after the break, we can cover anything that you may need. See you after the break. Welcome back, Mindsetters. I'm loving the interaction on the page, especially how you guys are helping each other during this very crucial time. I know some of you are very nervous, but you don't even need to fret because, I mean, we're here and that's what we're here for, so that you guys actually know what will happen in your exam and you are prepared for anything. Hey, Aslam.
That's for sure.
Yeah. So, guys, I know that there's some questions going. You can keep asking throughout the show. Don't forget that you can keep asking. And I also want to remind you about the winter school. Winter school is coming up soon on the 2nd of July. So you don't need to worry if maybe perhaps you're still not clued up on some of the things. Winter school is here to help you with exactly that. Over to you.
Thank you. Welcome back, guys. We move on to evolution. Before we go there, that one question.
Yes, there's a question Petros asked. What is an allele that is not shown in the phenotype when found in the heterozygous condition?
Listen to that question very carefully of Petros. He wants to know what is the allele that is found in the phenotype of, that is not shown, sorry, in the phenotype if an organism is heterozygous.
Yes.
First of all, we must understand heterozygous means what? That the gene and its allele are not the same. They are different, right? That's the first thing. And in this particular case, they want to know in the phenotype, this gene is not showing itself up. Why not? Obviously, this allele would have to be recessive. In other words, in our example of gray and white, we had capital G for gray and small g for white. Now, if these two are put together, that is heterozygous. There's one, there's the gene, and there's its allele. So this particular one, the small g, will not show itself in the phenotype. In other words, you cannot have a phenotype where the mouse has gray with white spots on it. You're only seeing either gray or you're seeing white. They are clearly distinguishing characteristics. So the recessive allele will not show itself in a heterozygous condition. I hope that answers your question, Petros. Moving on, we move to evolution, guys. We will, when we have chance again, in the winter school, hopefully, go back to some of the genetic type of questions. Now we're moving on to evolution, because most of you out there want to know when we're going to tackle some of the paper 2 issues. So we're going to do a little bit of evolution, and then we'll move on to the paper 2 items as well. It says, read the passage below and answer the questions that follow. All types of domestic dogs are capable of interbreeding to produce puppies, which will eventually be capable of interbreeding with any other domestic dog. Notice what I'm doing very carefully. I am underlining keywords. I spoke about this last time, that when you underline these keywords, you get to a stage eventually where you'd be able to do that in your mind. But now, while you're practicing, do it physically if you have to. Even if you have highlighters, use the highlighters also. The first dog evolved from a population of wolves. It is thought that wolves that were tamer than usual adopted humans in order to scavenge food from these refuse dumps near the human settlements. Although wolves look very similar to some breeds of domestic dogs, wolves and domestic dogs cannot interbreed. Very important clues given in this passage. That is why whenever you get a question, whether it's a passage, whether it's a data response, you must, I repeat, you must read very carefully. the information before you jump into the questions, because very important clues are given in the diagrams or in the passages. Let's move on. It says, explain why all breeds of domestic dogs belong to the same species. Why all domestic dogs belong to the same species. Now, where does this question come from? It comes from your knowledge of species. What is a species? A species is a group of organisms. One, what do? They share similar characteristics and characteristic. Wow, my spelling is going to the dogs. Must be all this BB that I'm busy with. Just going to abbreviate it there anyway. Characteristics. All right, let me show you. I can't spell it. Just now you think I can't spell. Okay. And they have similar characteristics. They can interbreed. And by the way, interbreed does not simply mean they must be able to have sexual relationships with each other. It means they must have sexual reproduction as such. In other words, they must have sexual relationships for producing offspring, interbreed, to breed, to make more offspring. And they produce fertile offspring. Now, can you see, first of all, why I'm writing all this down? And secondly, why I was underlining those important words? Now, the answer is in those important words and the definition. Let's go back. What did they tell us about all domestic dogs? They say they are capable of interbreeding. Obviously, all domestic dogs would share similar characteristics, obvious. That's the first given. Secondly, they told us they are capable of interbreeding. And their puppies are also capable of interbreeding. When we said in our definition, producing fertile offspring, we mean that the offspring, the puppies in this case, must also be able to produce offspring. When organisms of the same species mate and they have offspring, then their offspring can have more offspring. When organisms of different species mate or interbreed and they have offspring, then those offspring, if they do have, are generally sterile. That means they would not be able to have offspring. Classical example is the horse and the donkey giving you a mule. The mule cannot make more mules. So that's what we are talking about here. Describe how a population of wolves may have undergone speciation to form the first population of dogs. Now remember, this is based on the evolution concept of speciation, and they want to know how. Now, again, we were underlining some important words here. They said it here, the dogs evolved from a population of wolves. It is thought that wolves that were tamer than usual adopted humans. So in other words, what we're saying is that originally, this was one population. One population. For some reason, there was, not for some reason, we know why, when we discuss later why there's variety, because of meiosis, because of sexual reproduction, because of mutation, etc. There was variety or variation in the species, in this wolf population. Some were tamer. These tamer ones may have left the pack. Remember, wolves hunt in packs. They have left the pack and moved towards the human settlement. Why? Because they were tamer and they would not want to hunt, so they became scavenging. And while they were there, they got separated. Because they were separated from those other wolves, they could not interbreed with the other wolves. So therefore, they underwent natural selection independently. And again, going back to natural selection is the process whereby organisms that are stronger would survive at a particular time, in a particular place. It's not do or die rule in that particular time, in that particular place, one species may be stronger than the other, or one variant rather. One variant may be stronger than the other. Go back to your knowledge of the moths in Manchester. When the Industrial Revolution was at its peak, then obviously the darker moths survived. Why? Because they could not be seen according to the theory that goes with it. And therefore, the white moths were easily seen, and therefore they were eaten. So at that particular time, in that particular area, those moths, the darker variant, were stronger. However, after we became aware about pollution and its effect, and when Manchester cleaned itself up and the Industrial Revolution died down and there was not so much industry, and now that we are using various ways to protect the environment became a lighter shade. Now what happened? A different time, same place, but a different time. Conditions changed, and these conditions that changed favored the white moth. Now the white moth couldn't be seen because the environment was cleaner, it was easier to see the darker moth, so therefore the birds will eat the darker moths, and now the white variant increases. Now the same thing happens here. Natural selection happens, and in this case here now, independently of each other. And these organisms became genotypically, and phenotypically different from each other. Now, if we put the wolves and the dogs together, even though they're not separated anymore, we've taken away the separation, we put them together. Now they may not interbreed when put together, because they are new species. Now remember, according to the theory, it doesn't happen yesterday and then today all this happens. This is over several generations, long periods of time. Remember, evolution speak about 4.5 billion years, the Earth's life and its history. That's a long time. So please understand that this doesn't happen yesterday, that they got lost and they went their way, and tomorrow when they came back, now they're a new species. No, this is not what these people are saying. They are simply saying that over several generations, the one with this scavenging habit was surviving better in that area, and therefore it arose. The tamer one, obviously, would be adopted by the humans, and the human would keep the tamer one. The one that's not tame, it's wild, is going to attack the human. They're not going to keep it there with them. Then they say here, last one here, describe how artificial selection led to different breeds of domestic dogs. Now, we live in a day and age when artificial selection is part of our lives in different ways, not only in dogs, in sheep, in cattle, in fruit, in vegetables, etc. What we mean there is simply that farmers or in this case, not farmers, but the humans, they saw that certain characteristics are better than others. And because of that, they would then artificially select certain individuals to breed with other similar individuals so that they get a particular favorable characteristic. For example, a dog that looks very nice for a show, you're taking the dogs for dog shows, etc. It looks very nice. Therefore, they will take that characteristic and enhance it. Or a dog that runs very fast. So they have dog races, they can do the same with that type of thing. So that is what we're talking about. Artificial selection is when humans select certain favorable characteristics and they perpetuate it by mating these animals with similar animals so that the offspring probably have these favorable conditions. Any questions there, Kadleho?
No questions yet on what you're doing right now.
Okay.
Would you like to go for a quick break so that we can get more?
Yep, let's do that.
Okay, sure. Guys, let's go for a really quick break in order for you guys not only to get refreshed, but also to get all your questions in so that we can answer them right after this very quick break. Welcome back, Mindsetters. I'm glad that you guys are on the ball and you guys are enjoying this lesson. I know it's awesome for all that stuff that you may have forgotten to be put back into your awareness so that on Monday, when you write, or any other day perhaps, you know what to do. Remember that there's also winter school booklets that are given away to the first 5 callers that have questions today, and good questions. Our number that's on Facebook as well is 086-105-8262. You can call this number during the entire show just so that we have your questions and Mr. Aslam can answer them right on the show just for you. Over to you, sir.
Thanks, Katlego. Welcome back, Mindsetters. Also from my side, please post your questions on the Facebook page as well as call in. If you have even a particular question in a particular year that you want us to go through that we don't have on the screen right now, we would then put that on the screen and answer it for you as well. So please phone in with your questions. Another tip of advice as well, people. Remember, when you are studying, make sure that your teachers have given you what is called an exam guideline. This is not a state secret. It's an official document which any learner can have access to. You can even find it probably on the departmental website. But if not, you can get it from your teachers. They have it with them. Ask them to forward it to you so that you know that you are learning the right stuff. Remember, at the end of the year, there are 2 versions of the paper. Version 1, which is the current grade 12 full-time candidates that write, and version 2 is for those learners who didn't make it in 2010. And they're rewriting again. So please make sure that you know which version you are writing. And for that, you need the document called the exam guideline, so you know you're not messing up in terms of what you're learning. Just to move on to paper 2, because the requests are coming in fast and furious regarding paper 2. So we're moving to paper 2. And just to quickly recap what is in paper 2. The first one is plant hormones. Then we look at animal or human hormones, or the endocrine system. Then we move on to the nervous system. And here we talk of the central nervous system, which is the brain and spinal cord, and the sense organs. In the sense organ, we only focus on the eye, mind my pun on focus, focus on the eye and the ear. Those are the only 2 sense organs that you're going to need to know for this year. We move on from there to reproduction in humans, the topic you're probably all waiting for. Reproduction in humans and plants, and also some reproductive strategies in other animals. So that is where we're moving with that. We also finish there, the human part, with thermoregulation. That means the skin and what the skin does to keep us warm when it is cold, to keep us cool when it is warm. And thereafter, we go to environment. And in environment, you learn about population environment or population studies and social environment issues. We're talking about how organisms have a social network and what do they do to look after each other in the environment or in the wild. So this is basically what covers your paper 2 items. So you need to know these things for paper 2. It's longer in some ways than paper 1. So let's go to our first question here. Now, we've put this particular question more for the type of question than the content, because this covers all the content itself. But the important thing is to understand this question. The question is very clear. It says, indicate whether each of the statements in column 1, that's column 1, applies to A only, B only, both A and B, or none in column 2. So all you're going to do is you're going to write on your answer book 1.3.1 and next to it the answer. And your answer can either be any one of these bold characters here. A only, B only, both A and B, or both A and B, or none of the items. Please do not rewrite these statements in your answer book. You would not be credited marks for that. Let's go straight into the question. A tube that stores sperm cells until maturation. Now here, in an exam situation, we would have to specify probably in humans. Here's an example, so we did not specify that. But in an exam situation, we would have to say the human sperm in that case here. And in that case here, our answer is it stored in a vas deferens? What's the vas deferens again? The sperm duct. What's the job of the sperm duct? What are we testing here? We're testing whether you know the functions of the different parts in the male sex organs. And if you don't know that, you're in big problems. Now, vas deferens transports sperms from the testes through all the storage there, right up past the seminal vesicles, prostate gland, and so on, and eventually into the urethra where it's going to be ejaculated. So vas deferens does not store sperm, so it can't be A. The seminiferous tubules, guys, where are the seminiferous tubules? These are the tubules that make up the testes. These are the tubules that increase the surface area for the production of sperm. So in this particular case, obviously, your answer is none. Okay, the next one. The cell division that takes place in the gametophyte generation to form gametes. In the gametophyte generation, to form gametes. Very important clue here, to form gametes. Which one of these two is involved in the formation of gametes? By now you should know that, folks, and that is obviously A only. Mitosis is not there to form the gametes. Remember, however, in the formation of gametes, there may be some mitosis taking place, but to form these gametes, meiosis is chiefly responsible. Now, if we have this type of a question, at the end of the year, we may run into lengthy discussions, memo discussions, to finalize the answer in that particular case. Obviously, before that, we probably avoid that type of a question, because a learner may well say that there is a bit of mitosis even in the formation of the embryo, etc. But they specifically saying to form gametes. All right? Controls all voluntary action. Controls all voluntary action. And here your answer is A, cerebrum, controls. Now remember, the cerebellum doesn't control it, it coordinates it. The fact that I can lift my hand up and down and throw it around, whatever, that is controlled by the cerebrum. But the fact that my hand is not just going up and down without any coordination, the fact that if I throw the pen up, I'm not going to do that now because it falls and I'm in problems. If I had to throw the pen up and catch it, okay, I'll do it anyway, okay. The fact that I could throw the pen up, cerebrum. The fact that I could follow it up with my eye, and my eye and hand coordinate to catch it again, cerebellum. Coordination of the voluntary actions. Okay, the last one there. Body temperature varies with the environmental temperature. That means as the environmental temperature changes, the body temperature also changes. In this case here, it will obviously be B only, ectotherms. Endotherms are those that generate their own temperature from inside their body. Ectotherm, as it says, ecto from outside. They're depending on the environment. Therefore, you'll see most ectotherms in winter, etc., they become less active because the body temperature drops, and in terms of saving or conserving energy, they drop their metabolic activities to a bare minimum just to survive. Good, you'll notice there are 2 marks for each question here, and you can really score. Last year, end of the year 2011, and the March 2012 paper had many more of this, plus minus 7 or 8. So that's 16 marks, guys. 16 whole marks. You cannot mess up this question, and it's fairly easy. You need to know your work, though. Let's move on and straight into plant hormones. Now here again, I love these type of questions where they deal with investigations. A group of grade 12 learners carried out an investigation to determine the effect of gibberellin on the germination of the seeds. Remember, for your work, you need to only know the functions and functioning of auxins, gibberellins, and cytokinins. Those are the only three that you need to know. There are others in the textbook. You only have to worry about those three. Okay? The following procedure was followed. This, by the way, comes from March 2012. A sample of hazelnut seeds were divided into two groups, A and B. A gibberellin solution was added to the seeds in group A. Water was added to the seeds in group B. Both groups of seeds were allowed to germinate for 16 days. The percentage of seeds germinating in the two groups was recorded, and here are the results in a nice little graph. Okay? On the y-axis, the percentage germination, how well did they germinate? On the x-axis, we have time, independent variable, dependent variable. I will keep talking about independent and dependent because you need to know it when you're doing hypothesis. You need to know it when you're doing investigations. You need to know it when you're drawing a graph. The independent variable goes on the x-axis, the dependent variable on the y-axis. So keep remembering that all the time. And they give you a key. Notice also when you're drawing a graph, you make sure that you have a key as well. They're showing you here the one with the diamond is gibberellin. The one with the green squares, or squares, I think, is the one that was put in water. Are you with me? The first question says, formulate a possible hypothesis for this investigation. Let's go back to the investigation itself. What did they do? They wanted to know the effect of gibberellin on the germination of seeds. So obviously the hypothesis must hinge around this. But also note that they kept seeds in two different conditions. And what are the two characteristics, or rather the variables? The variables are the percentage germination. The percentage germination, let's go back to that graph. Here's the graph. The percentage germination, one variable. The other variable is time in this graph. But it wasn't time that we were checking. We weren't leaving them there on their own and checking against time. What did time do? We were worried about one in gibberellin and the other one in water. So our hypothesis must have these things in them. So we can say that the percentage germination, that will give you the one mark, of the seeds, etc., increases, or you can write decreases, in when, or rather when, placed in gibberellin.
Gibberellin.
Or water. Remember, this is a hypothesis. It's not based on the result. You formulate a hypothesis before you investigate. So can you see we got slashes here? So if the child wrote increases or decreases, you're still going to get a mark. If he wrote gibberellin or water there, you're still going to get a mark. If you put a question mark at the end of this, you get zero, even though you got all three variables, because a hypothesis is not a question. So please remember that. Right, so that was the first one. Second one, using the information from the graph, determine the percentage germination of hazelnut seeds on the 10th day. Let's go back to the graph. Simple question. Go to the 10th day. Look at this thing here, 4, 8, 12, 16. So 8, 12, there's a gap there. That should be 10. So you go up this line, up to there somewhere, and obviously you're somewhere in this area here. Notice you are not on the line where it says 80, so your answer cannot be 80. It's not halfway between 70 and 80, so your answer cannot be 75. Your answer has to be above 75. And it's closer to the line, so it should be between 77 or 78. That is your answer. And it's percentage. Because sometimes they give you two marks, you can do that. One mark in this case. Explain the purpose of group B. Group B were put in water. What did we want to know? Whether gibberellin affects the growth of plants. And we kept one in water. What did we do? We excluded gibberellin. So what does that become? That becomes the control. Why do we have a control? To compare our results, and we want to know that it's gibberellin indeed that caused the change and not anything else. So if we put it in water, that's what we can understand there.
Quick break. Let's do that. I know that there's a lot for them to take in and to, you know, let it simmer in your mind a little bit while we take a very, very quick break. Welcome back, Mindsetters. I hope you guys are ready for the last and intense segment of the show. This is when all your questions are welcome. And if perhaps you still have something that's niggling at your mind after this segment, there is a winter school from the 2nd of July to the 8th. So make sure that you are in tune for that boot camp. We're calling it a boot camp because it is going to be intense, and it's going to be on just what you need to push you over to the next year after matric, obviously. Over to you, Aslan.
Thanks, Katleho. Let's move on. We were busy with that question here. So the purpose of the Group B was to be a control to compare our results. And the last question, or the next question there, says, there's two ways in which validity of this investigation would be improved. Remember, guys, you must know the difference between validity and reliability. Reliability talks about whether if anybody else does this experiment, would they get the same result? So in other words, it's a reliable source of information. That means we can repeat this thing and get the same result. In question where they're asking reliability, the best answer there is to repeat the experiment, to increase the sample size, etc., etc., etc. But validity speaks to the method. Here we're talking about accuracy in terms of repeatability. Here we're talking about a method. Were the method valid? Did they make any mistakes, etc.? So they want to know here, in this case, two ways in which the validity of this improvement or this investigation could have been improved. You see, in the question, they did not talk about what type of seeds they're using, etc. So first of all, we must be able to say that they must use the same number of seeds in both. The seeds must come from the same plant. The amount or the volume of water and gibberellin, water and or gibberellin, must be the same. So these are the type of things you're going to make sure that you are watching for validity. That means the method, the way you're doing this experiment. One mustn't be given a different condition than the other one. We must keep the same. Also there we can talk about same environmental conditions as well for both. Otherwise, obviously, it could be the environmental factor that's throwing it off, or it could be the amount of water or gibberellins that could have thrown the thing off, etc., etc., etc. So notice, when you're talking of validity, you're talking about the method. When we're talking about reliability, you want to know whether if we do this experiment again, would it give us the same result? So in other words, when you want to know if somebody's reliable among your friends, you want to know whether the information they gave you was indeed true, okay? Last one, give one possible reason why seeds of desert plants germinate only after heavy rains. Now guys, this is an easy question. I'm sure learners in grade 4, 5, 6 could have answered this particular question. Why? Because they understand that for a plant to germinate, it needs water. Water is one of the requirements. So obviously, why would it germinate only after heavy rains? Is that there's abundance of water, so it can absorb water and germinate accordingly, and then it will be better conditions for that plant to grow in that time when there's enough water. This question here on the 2011 is very similar to the one we have done. So I'm going to skip this particular question because it's still dealing with plant hormones. You must also, after you do plant hormones, you must know plant defense mechanisms. How do plants protect themselves? That's a small bit, one paragraph in the book. Okay, so I'm skipping this whole one because the idea of this question is the same. Formulate hypothesis, etc. So it's no sense doing that. This one here, at the beginning of the show, we had a question saying that we must explain this section. Let's just look at it very quickly. In terms of the endocrine system, people, what must you know? You must know the gland. You must know where it is found. What are the hormones that it secretes from this gland that you're talking about? What are the functions of these hormones? And in some cases, what happens if there's too much over secretion, or if there is too little under secretion? That's what you need to know there. Notice 2011 November, 2012 March. The essay was based on the endocrine system, and the 2012 one, actually one of them, I'll check just now when we go down, actually deals with a little bit of both. Let's go on. So to give you a nice diagram here, and this is the best way to learn this section, by the way, draw this diagram on your book. Next to each gland, all, and you're going to add all your glands, name the gland so you can see where the gland is. Next to it, in another color, write down the names of the hormones that are secreted by that gland. In another color still, write down the functions of those hormones. And in still another color, what happens if there's too much or too little of that hormone? And notice when we're talking about over-secretion and under-secretion, guys, we are testing you the function. If this gland is, if this particular hormone is doing this, for example, adrenaline prepares you for an emergency. If you're going to have too much, you'll become paranoid. You'll think there's an emergency all the time. You'll be anxious. Who's coming? Who's behind me? Etc. So that's the type of questions that you expect there. They say label the parts 1 and 4. 1 is the pituitary gland. Pituitary gland. Also known as the hypophysis. Please note, for exam purposes, the word master gland is not accepted. 4, on top of the kidney, is obviously the adrenal gland. Okay? Moving on, write down the number of the gland that A, produces the hormone glucagon. Glucagon is produced by number 3, the pancreas, islets of Langerhans to be more specific. B, produces hormone that controls the growth of long bones, would be number 1, the pituitary gland growth hormone. C, produces an iodine containing hormone, something that has iodine from the thyroid gland, number 2. And last one there, produces a hormone that is involved in the reabsorption of some salts by the kidney, and that would be number 4, the adrenal gland, which secretes adrenaline and aldosterone. State 2 similarities between hormones and nerves. Okay. The similarities are that they both prepare the body for emergencies and they are protection. And unfortunately, we'd have to end at that particular question. When we meet again, we can look at some other questions. I hand over to Katlego.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Mindsetters, for such an awesome show. I wish you the best of luck for all your exams and enjoy the rest of your youth day. Remember to learn more and learn extra about it as much as you learn with us. See you next time. Bye.